Test, 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 1, 2. Test, 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 1, 2.
Hearing will come to order. Mr. Langevin is on his way, and so we'll look forward to seeing him shortly. But in the meantime, we're supposed to have votes 4:45 or 5, and y'all could not possibly wait through all those votes. So we want to try to get all our questions before that. So we're going to go ahead and get started. Let me thank everybody for being here. When most of us gathered this time last year, we talked about the dangers of cutting S&T in tight budgetary times, and we are having tight budgetary times. According to our calculations, these accounts were cut about 2.5%. It's tempting to say it could have been worse, and obviously it could have been. And yet part of our concern is not just the total dollar figure, but how we are all spending the taxpayers' money. And so there are many topics for us to get to today, and we will do so through the course of our questions. But let me go ahead and turn to our witnesses, and we appreciate each of you being here. We have the Honorable Zachary Limnios, Assistant Secretary of Defense for Research and Engineering. Dr. Marilyn Freeman, Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Army for Research and Technology. Rear Admiral Matthew Klunder, Chief of Naval Research. Dr. Stephen Walker, Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Air Force for Science, Technology, and Engineering. And Dr. Ken Gabriel, Deputy Director of DARPA. Each of you have submitted written statements. Thank you for those. Without objection, they will be made part of the record. And if we could ask each of you to summarize your statement in about 5 minutes or so, then we will move from there to questions. So, Mr. Secretary, I'll turn it over to you to start.
Good afternoon, Chairman Thornberry and members of the committee. I just have a few short statements that summarize my written testimony, which will be in the record. The President's $11.9 billion request for DoD science and technology supports the President's defense strategy and reflects his commitment to ensure a strong S&T enterprise to develop the advanced capabilities upon which our men and women in uniform have come to rely upon. This request provides the necessary resources to maintain the decisive technological edge for today's challenges and the foundation to stay ahead of the most lethal and disruptive threats of the future. The ability of the joint forces to project power and succeed in future operations is increasingly challenged by new capabilities made possible by advances in technology and by new tactics that employ commercial technologies in new and innovative ways. The clear technical advantage upon which our forces have come to rely and which we currently enjoy can only be guaranteed with a dedicated and sustained effort. The globalization of technology, which we've discussed previously, has enabled the rise of global research and development investments and has collapsed the pace of innovation for both the U.S. and our adversaries. This has opened up new opportunities for technological surprise. It's both a challenge and it's an opportunity for exploitation. The President's budget request provides the right mix of programs and investments in basic, applied, and advanced research to guarantee our leadership position. It includes a number of enterprise initiatives across the department that ensure these valuable resources are invested wisely, with focus, and with the goal of accelerating the transition of concepts into capabilities for our forces. Importantly, our success is made possible by the important work of our dedicated scientists and engineers, both in the Department of Defense and in the larger S&T enterprise that we discussed this last year. That enterprise is comprised of academia, industry, our federal laboratories, our federally funded research development centers, and our university-affiliated research centers. This is the most impressive collection of technical talent to be found anywhere in the world, and our budget request provides the necessary resources to keep this enterprise healthy and strong. Mr. Chairman, thank you for the opportunity to present these brief remarks. The congressional support for the President's budget for the research and engineering enterprise will have the resources I need to ensure a strong technical base to enhance our nation's security, and I look forward to your questions. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Chairman Thornberry, and the distinguished members of the subcommittee. I appreciate the opportunity to discuss the fiscal year 13 Army S&T program and the significant role of S&T in supporting our warfighters. I want to thank the members of this committee for your important role in supporting our soldiers who are at war, and for your advocacy of the Army's S&T investments that will sustain our technological preeminence to our future soldiers. Your continued support is vital for our success. My vision for Army S&T is to invent, innovate, and demonstrate technology-enabled capabilities that empower, unburden, and protect our soldiers. I hear often, as I'm sure you do, from soldiers themselves that technology saved their lives and was critical to their remarkable accomplishments. When I became DASA R&T a year and a half ago, I embarked on a path to change the perception that Army S&T was irrelevant. This path is leading to a significant change of the S&T culture, and it is still a work in progress. We now actively engage with senior Army leadership, the Army staff, senior executives of the laboratories and centers, and all parts of TRADOC to establish real priorities for Army S&T prior to the beginning of the formal Army POM cycle. In 2011, for the first time, we collaboratively developed a set of 24 challenges on which to focus our near-term research efforts. We formulated a number of new programs to begin in FY13 that address these challenges, and by the end of FY17 to demonstrate new technology-enabled capabilities. In the coming year, I intend to develop a set of programs to better define and prioritize the rest of the S&T portfolio. For the remainder of the 6-2 and the 6-3 funding, we will formulate programs to meet the midterms needs of the program executive offices and program managers. We will also create programs to develop and demonstrate technologies that have a high potential to bridge gaps or achieve leap-ahead technologies and capabilities. Additionally, we will establish a set of priorities for our basic research efforts, problems and challenges against which better programs can be formulated and executed. Of course, we will do all of this in concert with the guidance provided by the Defense Strategy for the 21st Century and the OSD S&T priorities. In 2013, the Army is placing increased emphasis on investment in ground and aviation vehicle survivability, research in focal plane arrays, and alternative fuels for ground vehicles. We will accept some greater risk through reducing funding and lethality, unmanned autonomous ground vehicles, and military engineering. As we adjust to an era of decreasing or flat budgets, Army S&T must be capable of doing more with less and correctly managing the risk associated with shrinking budgets by identifying and focusing on the highest priorities for the future. I believe that the S&T management strategy allows us to do just that. And as I mentioned last year, I continue to have major concerns with the long-term health of our laboratory, both infrastructure and workforce. And as Dr. Lemnius has said, it's important that we keep the cadre of scientists and engineers in our laboratory systems to solve our problems. It is absolutely essential that we work on this problem together, and I hope to do so with you. While we have some basic improvements to our infrastructure through the BRAC processes, we do not have a long-term good policy or answer to how we work on our infrastructure. And we really, really need to have more discussions about that. And in closing, I'd like to thank Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to testify here and for your support of the Army science and technology investments. I'm proud to represent the efforts of over 12,000 Army scientists, engineers, technicians, and research professionals dedicated to our soldiers with world-class technology-enabled capabilities. I will be pleased to answer your questions and those of this subcommittee.
Good afternoon, Chairman Thornberry, Ranking Member Langevin, and the members of the committee. It's certainly an honor to be here before you today to report on science and technology efforts within the Department of the Navy and discuss how the President's FY 2013 budget request supports the Navy and the Marine Corps. I am accompanied today by Brigadier General Mark Wise, the commander of the Marine Corps Warfighting Lab in Quantico, Virginia. He is a great partner in our effort to lead the Navy and Marine Corps science and technology community. Our objective is to support a Navy and Marine Corps capable of prevailing in any environment with the understanding that anti-access and aerial denial threats will continue to increase in the future. We work directly with the Secretary of the Navy, Chief of Naval Operations, and the Commandant to achieve this goal. We do that by, one, focusing on S&T areas with big leap-ahead payoffs, but also, two, encouraging innovative thinking and business processes to make our existing systems more effective. And finally, three, we are constantly striving to improve transition of S&T into acquisition programs to enable the most cost-effective weapon systems possible. In the spirit of this striving for affordability, we are also working to strike the right balance between responsive near-term technology insertions and also long-term basic research. While the starting point is continued evolution of current systems, we progress towards incremental improvements in spiral development of known technologies to known development of undiscovered disruptive technologies. Our portfolio across all the Navy and Marine Corps balances a range of complementary but also competing imperatives, and that we support advances and initiatives in existing established operational areas while still also looking at far-reaching complementary of long-term research efforts that may prove disruptive to traditional operational concepts. Our ability to support the wider warfighter also depends on our ability to sustain a science and technology, engineering and mathematics, STEM workforce in our active and reserve ranks and our research laboratories. We believe the key to achieving this goal lies in supporting STEM education and a continuum of experiences from kindergarten all the way through postdoctoral opportunities. Now, I believe many of you all, and certainly your staff, sir, are familiar with many of our technology programs. If I can, I'd just like to highlight two, the electromagnetic railgun, and the free electron laser. Our discussions with your staff during the FY 2012 authorization process led to refinements in that railgun program and planning about which SECNAV and I will come to you later next month and report as per the FY12 National Defense Authorization Act. Similarly, the discussions with the Navy and with your staff also led to refinements in the FEL program, which we intend to implement this year. In that implementation where we're focusing on components of FEL, we're also looking to mature our solid-state laser technology with our sister services. We have made significant contributions to the fleet and the forces' ability to share information across combat systems, command and control systems, and intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance systems. In the world of cyber warfare and information dominance, we do believe it is critical that we are able to integrate systems into a common information environment that is modular, based on open standards and automated, and allow for a reduction in manpower requirements and acquisition costs. All of these issues are outlined in some detail in my written testimony, along with more detailed surveys that are enclosed in our ONR contributions, such as areas as irregular warfare, unmanned systems, and also medical care for our wounded warriors. I would certainly be remiss if I did not mention the stellar contribution that's made by our entire workforce at all the Navy labs and warfare centers, with special recognition for the Naval Research Laboratory right nearby in Anacostia. Many of your staff have visited, but I certainly invite all of you to take advantage of an opportunity to see this nearby facility firsthand. The work is absolutely impressive. The people are impressive. One of our greatest challenges, certainly as Marilyn alluded to, is to recapitalize on our facilities, in this case, in the NRL facilities, and to ensure continuation of their cutting-edge work. I thank you again for your tremendous support and look forward to answering your questions. I do believe that the state of our Navy and Marine Corps S&T investments are sound. They represent good stewardship of the taxpayers' dollars, and we believe they enhance significantly the safety and performance of our warfighters today and well into the future. And thank you, sir. I'll be ready for any questions.
Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee and staff, I am pleased to have the opportunity to provide testimony on the fiscal year 2013 Air Force Science and Technology Program. To protect our nation amidst a myriad of current and future security challenges, the Air Force must be an agile, flexible, ready, and technologically advanced part of the joint team. The Air Force S&T program plays a vital role by creating compelling air, space, and cyberspace capabilities for precise and reliable global vigilance, reach, and power. The Air Force 2013 President's budget request for S&T is approximately $2.2 billion, which includes nearly $200 million in support of devolved programs consisting of high-energy laser efforts and the University Research Initiative. This year's budget request represents a decrease of $64 million, or about a 2.8% reduction from fiscal year 2012. This reflects a more modest reduction than taken across the total Air Force budget and indicates the strong support for science and technology from our leadership. The Air Force S&T fiscal year 2013 President's budget request supports the following overarching priorities as detailed in our S&T strategy. Priority one is to support the current fight while advancing breakthrough S&T for tomorrow's dominant warfighting capabilities. While developing technologies to equip our forces of tomorrow is the primary objective of S&T, our dedicated scientists and engineers are equally motivated to contribute to the current fight by getting their technologies into the hands of the warfighter. Excuse me. For example, Air Force S&T has played a significant role in developing and delivering combat capability to our warfighters in the CENTCOM AOR through the deployment of a concept or a system called Blue Devil. This persistent intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance capability demonstrated the first ever integration of wide area field of view and narrow field of view high definition day and night sensors cued by advanced signals intelligence. Warfighter feedback on the situational awareness provided by Blue Devil Block 1 has been overwhelmingly positive. Priority two is to execute a balanced, integrated S&T program that is responsible to the Air Force core functions. In light of the defense strategic guidance released last month, we ensured our current strategies and plans were appropriately aligned with new and enduring emphasis areas. Our S&T program supports the Air Force capabilities fundamental to the major priorities of the guidance, such as deterring and defeating aggression, projecting power in anti-access and aerial denial environments, operating in the space and cyberspace domains, and maintaining a safe, secure, and effective strategic deterrent. We've also engaged the small business community in this endeavor through the Rapid Innovation Fund, which is focused on key technology areas such as supporting current contingency operations, cyberspace security, mission assurance, improved system sustainment, and power generation and energy for our platforms. Priority three is to retain and shape the critical competencies needed to address the full range of S&T product and support capabilities. We're continuing to support Air Force science, technology, engineering, and mathematics initiatives to develop and optimally manage the S&T workforce of the future through our Bright Horizons strategic document. Our newly established Air Force level STEM outreach office ensures effective coordination with other service and agency STEM programs and gives us a better understanding of the effectiveness and impact of our STEM investments. Finally, priority four is to ensure the Air Force S&T program addresses the highest priority capability needs of the Air Force. Our process for creating and executing Air Force flagship capability concepts over the last 2 years is maturing well. We've continued the high-velocity penetrating weapon concept to demonstrate critical technologies to reduce the technical risk for a new generation of penetrating weapons to defeat difficult, hard targets. And we've continued the selective cyber ops technology integration program, which is executing smoothly toward providing cyber technologies capable of affecting multiple nodes for the purposes of achieving a military objective. While the Air Force decommissioned our responsive space access FCC during our annual review this year, we commissioned a new FCC for precision airdrop to develop technologies to improve airdrop accuracy and effectiveness while minimizing risk to our air crews. In conclusion, this budget request reflects our refocused S&T portfolio given budgetary challenges and the new defense strategic guidance. I believe this request also reflects the promise of future warfighting capability enabled by the technologies that will be developed with this investment. Mr. Chairman, I thank you again for the opportunity to testify today, and thank you for your continued support of the Air Force S&T program.
At DARPA, we're often asked to predict the future. After all, since it was created in 1958, DARPA's singular mission has been to prevent and create strategic surprise. It may appear that the best way to fulfill that mission is to predict what's next. But at DARPA, we believe it's not about predicting the future, it's about building it. Chairman Thornberry, Ranking Member Langevin, members of the subcommittee, my name is Ken Gabriel. I'm the Deputy Director of DARPA. I could discuss some of the agency's accomplishments over the last year, including the second flight of HGV-2 or Blast Gauge, a wristwatch sized device to measure overpressure and TBI. But instead, what I'd like to talk to you about today is what keeps us up at night. in anti-access and area denial, the global electronics industry, unintentionally and without malice, has created vulnerabilities. Computing, imaging, and communication capabilities that as recently as 15 years ago were the exclusive domain of military systems are now in the hands of hundreds of millions of people around the world. We don't argue against the benefits such capabilities have brought. Indeed, many of the commercial advances have roots in DARPA programs from decades past. But these vulnerabilities are not an abstract threat. Electronic warfare, EW, was once the province of a few peer adversaries. Today, it is possible to purchase commercial off-the-shelf components, COTS, for more than 90% of the electronics in an EW system. Nearly a dozen countries are now producing EW systems at ever-increasing pace, from a new system every 10 years decades ago to one every 1.5 years today. These insights led us to new investments that leverage COTS technology where we can and develop technologies where COTS can't or won't go. One example of leveraging COTS is the Intrachip Enhanced Cooling Program. Cooling a COTS chip allows us to, for example, run the chip 10 times faster than it was designed to run, creating differentiating capabilities for ourselves. DARPA's Adaptive RF Technologies Program seeks to extend the range of military radar and radios by developing high-power transmit and receive modules, something the commercial industry has no use for and where COTS won't go. In cybersecurity, there has been much focus on increasing our defensive capabilities, but we require capabilities in both defense and offense across the full spectrum of the conflict. DoD tasks and purposes are sufficiently different that we cannot simply scale intelligence cyber capabilities and adequately serve the needs of the DoD. Modern warfare demands the effective use of cyber and kinetic means. That requires DoD cyber capabilities matched to our kinetic options. We launched several programs designed to create cyber capabilities with the diversity, dynamic range, and tempo of DoD operations. Cyber Fast Track is just one such program. It taps a pool of non-traditional experts and innovators, many of them members of the White Hat hacker community. To some, hacker evokes concern, but hacker is a positive term that describes a person of exceptional capability and creativity, someone who sees a novel use for an existing capability or technology. In the last 7 months, more than 100 proposals were received and 32 awards were made, 84% of them small companies and performers who have never done business with the government before. Cyber Fast Track is expanding the number and diversity of talent contributing to the nation's cybersecurity. Some of these observations today feel uncomfortable, even to us. Our responsibility, however, is to the uncomfortable. They are the seeds of what allow us to fulfill our mission to prevent and create strategic surprise. Thank you.
Thank you, and I really appreciate everybody being brief. This is always a challenging hearing for me because there's so many interesting things to talk about. It's hard to talk about it within the time limits we have, but y'all did a good job, and I appreciate it. I'm going to yield first to Mr. Langevin for any opening statement he would like to make, and then go right ahead for with any questions you may have. Mr. Langevin.
big weapons procurement may talk about one system that alone could cost over $100 million. $100 million in the S&P world could mean dozens of early stage programs or demonstration programs. You can't go through your entire S&P, but I would appreciate a brief comment on areas supporting directed energy and the development and tests of technologies supporting prompt global strike. And for those of you who care to also elaborate more on cyber, I would appreciate that as well. Additionally, I believe this committee and frankly all of Congress would benefit from your oral statement on the implementation and early success, if any, of the Rapid Innovation Program. And lastly, but with special importance to myself and the chairman, I'd like to take some time today to explore the critical and uniquely dynamic area of cybersecurity research and development. As we all know, the nation faces serious cybersecurity threats and vulnerabilities that cut across .mil, .gov, and .com alike. And I look forward to hearing more about the department's research and investments and strategy to develop the tools and capabilities that we need to operate effectively and securely in the cyber domain, both now and in the future. With that, I'd like to thank all of you once again for appearing for us today, and look forward to our questions. Thank you very much, and with that, Mr. Chairman, I'll...
Yeah, you want to go ahead and do your questions?
Sure.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you, Chairman. Dr. Gabriel, if I could start with you. With the rapidly changing needs of today's warfighter, how does DARPA choose what to invest in and what to build? In other words, how do you come to the decision that a subject area is DARPA hard?
Well, sir, as you might imagine, the challenge at DARPA is not coming up with ideas, it's choosing from among them, as you point out. We do deep analytical analysis of thrust areas that we see as important capabilities for the Department of National Security. Those analytics define and point out areas where we see divergences and where we see opportunities. We've done them in a number of areas, including cyber, which many of you have seen, the cyber analytical framework. And from those frameworks, we take the ideas and essentially ask three key questions. Is this area game-changing, and will it have lasting impact? The second criteria we assess it against is this an area that requires DARPA expertise and capabilities? Not every idea worth doing is something that DARPA should do. The third question that we ask when we assess choosing between programs is how does it balance the rest of our investments? Because we have limited resources and bandwidth, and we must choose our investments wisely so that we can meet the mission of the agency to prevent and create strategic surprise.
Thank you, Dr. Gabriel. Let me turn to cyber and Secretary Lemnios. I'm pleased to see the emphasis on cybersecurity in each of your testimony here today, and I'm also pleased that since last year's hearing on these matters, the Department of Defense has identified cyber as one of the department's seven key S&T areas. Secretary Lemnios, how are you ensuring that the various defense cyber R&D efforts are both responsive to the DoD strategy for operating in cyberspace and well-coordinated across agencies and individual laboratories?
Representative Langevin, we're as you know, cyber is one of our department's seven S&T priorities. We began the rebalance of the S&T enterprise for the department about 18 months ago in identifying those priorities. And in doing so, we had long conversations with the operators, with the uniformed members of the services and the operators that would actually use those capabilities. We built a set of architectures, and we're actually now working the capability sets to develop that tech base. With regard to cyber, I imagine you see all sorts of folks in this room that can give you opinions on how to assess the quality of cyber concepts. We've had the discussion both in the private sector and certainly in government circles. The focus of our effort this past year has been to build a measurement framework so that we can start assessing with data how fragile our networks are, where there are vulnerabilities, and how do we take S&T concepts, science and technology concepts, and transition those. DARPA has been a key part of that in developing cyber range concepts several years ago. We started to transition those well into the services and into other agencies. And across the department, we brought together the science and technology community to start working those issues in collaboration. So we, in fact, have efforts that are cross-correlated across the enterprise. I think the focus here is the pace of innovation in cyber and how we transition those concepts. And as I've spoken with many of you before on this, that's been some of your concerns. How do we transition ideas from a research bench into an operational bench? And we're actually very focused on that.
Very good. Obviously, one of the priorities that I have, too, is making sure that we're continuing to develop the cyber workforce and
that we make sure that we have good situation awareness about who has those capabilities within the various services. And something I encourage you to consider is pressing the various services to survey in those areas. You know, some of the brightest minds in many ways with cyber, and they may not be the admirals and the colonels and the captains. It's going to be the newest recruits that that grew up with this technology and can take this stuff like fish to water. We ought to have a robust understanding of what those capabilities are and how we can plug them into the right fields. Let me just turn before my time expires. Dr. Gabriel, you noted, I believe correctly, that we simply cannot scale intelligence community cyber capabilities to the needs of .mil. Additionally, in the past, Dr. Dugan has stressed the need to address the divergence of the threats we face and the defenses that we use against them. Where do you view DARPA's niche with regards to addressing tomorrow's cyber challenges? And for the panel, if you could comment, what do we need to change to ensure that we are better able to identify and mitigate risks in the cyber domain?
One of the ways in which we've been looking at how we can uniquely contribute in this area is recognizing that cybersecurity is not just about bits and networks. It's about the security of physical systems and embedded systems. And an activity that we're undertaking, which we'd be happy to come and talk to you in a more classified environment about, is how we, from our unique perch, are able to bring together folks from across the spectrum for that kind of threat and look at systems not only from the perspective of computer science and cybersecurity folks, but EW people, embedded systems and computer architecture, and knock down the walls between those stovepipes so that we can get an integrated look at what are the opportunities and the threats involved in that. And from that insight of the integrated look, get new capabilities and new solutions that were not possible to get from any one domain itself. So that, along with some of the things we've talked about in the past about how we become convergent with the threat of cyber by programs like PROCEED and CRASH, which we've described before, which seek to attack the asymmetry of the cybersecurity challenge.
Let me get back around on, if I could, so other members can have a chance to ask, and then we'll come back to this cyber, because I think Mr. Langevin asked a very good question of everybody, and I want to get back, because I think everybody has a contribution to make here. Let me, just from an overall standpoint, ask each of you to comment on your budget in the following ways. Number one, what have you done differently as a result of the new strategy? If at all. Number two, what are you doing less of? And Dr. Friedman mentioned some of this in your opening statement. The Air Force written statement gives, pretty blunt, we got to do less of this thing. And that's what we need to know, too. So if we could just go down the line very briefly in my 5 minutes, how does the strategy affect what you're doing, and what are you doing less of that would increase risk? Secretary Limnos?
So, again, we started this process almost a year ago, 18 months ago, and looking at what the S&T priorities, how those line up. In fact, I had an opportunity last fall to take about 3 months and go through the entire scope of the department's projects, 270 program elements, 30,000 briefing charts. I visited all our laboratories and all the programs that we could sort of go through. The result of that was to give me confidence that not only the dollar request, but the content of that request was properly aligned. So I was looking for those places that would align, those concepts, the technical concepts, would align to the department strategy that came out about a month ago. And as a result, in the president's budget request, we realigned projects. We added a big push in hypersonics. We put a big push in the Air Force in an advanced engine. We put a additional funding in the Army for advanced imagers. Funding at DARPA was added in advanced manufacturing, about $300 million. We added funding in a variety of areas, electronic warfare, cyber, autonomy. So we actually shaped this budget based upon a close look at the projects we had in concert with the department strategy. At the OSD level, at the department level, within my direct office, I actually reduced our staffing, and I pushed many of the projects that we were executing within OSD out to the services to execute. I think it's a far more effective way to run those. It's a tighter coupling to the services, and it results in far better transitions.
Okay. Thank you. And I realize this is hard to get in the limited time we have but I appreciate the specifics. That helps. Dr. Freeman?
So your first question is, what have we done differently in light of the 21st century strategy that came out? And basically, right now, we have not done a lot. It has not made us change a lot in our focus, because over this last year, our focus had already shifted to the soldier in the small combat unit and what they need and the capabilities they need, which are really wherever they go to do what all the missions that need to be done. So we did not take a look at really changing anything in this budget to do that. We did, however, intend to be, as I described, our process tends that we can actually take a look now over this next year at to anything we need to do in the 6-2 and the 6-3 budget that would need to be shifted as we look. And we did take a little extra risk, as I said, in unmanned vehicles and the command and control of them, focusing the additional effort in autonomy to understanding the issues that soldiers have with respect to trust of autonomous vehicles, trust of ground vehicles, and being able to use them as team members. And we also took a little bit in the UAV airborne radar world, because we just didn't have enough money to focus on more than one radar at a time. I think those are the two major efforts.
Thank you. That's exactly what I'm looking for. Admiral?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. With our budget, we felt, even with before the new DOD strategy came out, we certainly got enough assessments and capability gaps to understand that we needed to refocus and know where the tilt in our anti-access, anti-area denial focus should be. We actually had, before this DOD strategy came out in January, we had 13 focus areas for the Naval S&T strategic plan. We have now brought those down to a total of 9. I will offer that of those 9, 5 of them are specifically directed towards anti-access area denial. That'd be assured access, battle space. It'd be autonomy and unmanned systems, expeditionary and irregular warfare, our information dominance and cybersecurity, and then our power projected and integrated defense. Those are the 5 that brought into the A2AD specifically. And what we haven't done for the last number of years, and we're not patting ourselves on the back, but we by far had the most accurate oceanographic modeling and forecasting models in the world. We felt we certainly aren't doing away with those. Yeah. They're very important. But we know that at this point, in terms of maturity, we are in pretty good shape there, and those could take a slight reprieve. I also offered in some of our planform designs, we're very mature in the ships we've designed recently and some of our planned aircraft. We think, again, right now, for this time being, we haven't done anything dramatic, but we've at least reduced some of the focus there.
Okay.
And I think that would probably be the two areas, sir.
That's great. Dr. Walker.
Sir, we responded to the defense planning guidance, spent the better part of two to three months working with the lab to identify where we should lead, watch or integrate with others, and then follow based on our core competencies as well as the new strategy. We are all over the A2AD area in the Air Force. We have a new investment in turbine engine, adaptive technologies for turbine engines. This is an area where we've always led and want to continue to lead. Hypersonics and supersonic activity for Alcon replacements, and looking at how we do things quicker and over longer ranges, and then weapons for fifth gen aircraft. We want to develop those, as well as electronic warfare, as we move into A2AD environments. What we had to decrease was work in micro UAVs, deployed air-based technology, some thermal sciences, and then some plug-and-play activity for small sats that we just never got the industry to buy into. So, yeah. Thank you.
Okay, perfect. Dr. Gabriel, did the strategy affect y'all?
Well, sir, we're certainly informed by the strategy, but along with our own analytic frameworks, which I've just discussed with you with ISR and others, PN, position, navigation, and timing, I can summarize that what we have done, what we're doing more of, is cyber and manufacturing. Cyber in particular, both defense and offense, and particularly cyber capabilities that are uniquely DOD needs, vice, say, intelligence needs. Mm-hmm. In manufacturing, it's one that you've heard us talk about before, controlling for time to get at some of the vulnerabilities associated with the increasing time that it takes us to field defense systems. What we're doing less of is energy and autonomy, frankly. Not that we're never going to do things in that those areas again, but we have finite resources, and we're focusing them on cyber and manufacturing.
Interesting. Thank you. Mr. Klein.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all witnesses for being here, for your testimony, for, as the chairman said, keeping that testimony under 5 minutes. It may be a world record. I don't know. I hope somebody recorded it. I was very fascinated by the testimony, particularly of the Navy and the Air Force on STEM. You have several pages, Admiral, in your testimony, and Dr. Walker, you mentioned it. I actually don't know anybody who's opposed to more science, technology, engineering, mathematics, education. Mr. Langevin missed it. Last year, I was invited to speak to a group of chamber folks in Rochester, Minnesota. They were exploring what the chamber could do about STEM, and so they wanted to know, they wanted me to come down and talk about what the federal government was doing, and knowing I had to give that speech, I actually looked it up, actually my staff did, and it turns out that at that time, last summer, there were 209 federal STEM programs, 209, and I don't know if that included iridescent, sea perch, FIRST Robotics, exploring youth exploring science, and the rest of them, and I see, Admiral, that ONR was tasked with coordinating naval STEM educational and research and outreach activities, and apparently the ONR Naval STEM Coordination Office provides a cohesive approach to STEM education and outreach across the service laboratories and warfare centers. And Dr. Walker, you've got something called Bright Horizons. What I'm getting at, and it's my question, and I'm just sort of focusing on you two, is how coordinated are you? I mean, it does seem to me that 209 might be maybe enough in terms of numbers of programs, and you're involved in them at the kindergarten level. Gosh, I hope you have a lot of people and a lot of money to do this, or at least that you are, in fact, coordinated and know what those other 208 programs are so that we can make sure we're getting a return. Admiral, tell us how that's working.
Yes, sir. Your timing of your question is perfect, sir, because just this morning I had coffee with a large, large room of exactly those individuals to try and coordinate those efforts. I think everyone, and certainly from the Navy and Marine Corps, we value STEM. We feel that everyone's been very excited about it. But what we're trying to do in that exact point, sir, about coordinating the efforts in really true collaboration so we're not duplicating efforts. Now what we're trying to do is, and we had this very healthy talk this morning, we've tried to move to a next level of phase two of the effort. And I don't mean from funding necessarily. I mean from, have we truly identified those events, those project-based learning, not day-long events, but maybe it's a 2 or 3 day-long event, trying to determine where do we get the best return, the best connective tissue that leads us into an actual person, young person, entering a STEM kind of career path for the future. I'm here, frankly, as I always would, sir, to tell you that the initial phase of this was a lot of excitement, a lot of movement, a lot of momentum, but truly we haven't, the collective group hadn't been able to identify yet where were we on a return. Now we're starting to see that. We're starting to look at where the internships increased, where the direct entry in the Navy Marine Corps with a STEM background increased, where our undergraduate going to a graduate program that may service not only just a Navy and Marine Corps laboratory, but also my colleagues' laboratories, but also just the nation as a whole. And that's what we're trying to get right now for not only the Secretary of Navy, but working with my colleagues in the Air Force, sir.
So if I could, thank you. So this meeting today included just Navy-related, or would the Air Force folks come in, or?
We had a number across not just Navy and Marine Corps disciplines, but also a number of those civilian organizations you just described, sir.
Well, that's good to hear, and I think it's important that you do that. I hate to see us putting the resources of scarce resources of people as we're cutting them back. The DDR&E or the Assistant Secretary has already cut back staff, and yet we have people with great excitement and great goodwill running around trying to help in the STEM area, and I do think that 210, 211, 212, 213, 14, 15 may be just a tad more than we need. I'd a whole lot rather see them coordinated and get some return for that investment, and I appreciate your effort there, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for joining us. Secretary, I wanted to ask you about the your department's Office of Small Business Programs and the Rapid Innovation Programs that you've put the requests out for, I guess, in you said four areas. And it sounds like you had a good response to that, but I wonder if you could tell us a little bit more about, were you tasking generally just these four areas, and what do you have to help us out with these? If you got that many responses, I mean, how are you dealing with that? One of the things that I bet I share with all of my colleagues is a lot of frustration on the part of small business developers that it's very hard for them to get through the morass of getting attention, obviously, when they have something significant. Could you talk a little bit more about that? And what do you expect to happen as a result of this?
Representative Davis, that's the connection that we're building and strengthening with the small business community is absolutely essential in driving innovative concepts from the private sector into the department's key capabilities. It's absolutely essential. The timelines, industry gets it. The small business communities are ways to drive new concepts that just simply won't arrive out of long-term procurements. This committee understands that. Congress passed the Rapid Innovation Fund that we're acting on now. We issued four solicitations, one from each of the services, and then one that's an OSD solicitation that includes the Fourth Estate. It includes SOCOM, the Small Business Innovative Research Program. I think DARPA was included in that one, and MDA. So that was a broad reach. Asking the small business community to come back with two focus efforts. One were your ideas that would, within 2 years and within a $3 million cap, provide solutions for our joint urgent operational needs. That is, those solutions that could be immediately transitioned to the warfighter. The second was those ideas that would have significant impact to our acquisition programs. It would tie directly to an acquisition program. We're still in source selection, but what I can tell you is that we received, as a result of those four solicitations, about 3,500 responses. I'm the source selection authority for one of those four activities. The other services are working those through their channels. But we did two things. We presented to industry a clear articulation of those challenges in an unclassified environment that sort of made it clear in layman's terms, and we listened to industry to try to shape the responses so that, in fact, we're able to make those connections, not just for this solicitation, but for the follow-on activities. The way we will assess it will be not just, is the money spent, did we actually get contracts on the record, but have we received the products as a result of that? You know, can I go to SOCOM, can I go to an operator and see the result of that small business concept implemented in that operational capability, or to that acquisition program, that transition path? It's an experiment. Mm-hmm. We are in the first phase. We've been working lockstep with the Hill to make sure that we're implementing it as you've directed us to.
Is that $200 million going to enable you to do what you'd like to do in terms of really getting it?
Well, it's actually twice that. It's actually $400 or $500 million, so it's a large amount of money. But we want to make sure that the first set of solicitations are executed synchronously and that we see the results. So the results of this will be evaluated as we go forward.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that. If you come across a situation where perhaps our larger companies are looking at those as well, and they certainly have that opportunity to do that. But I think when you talk about pushing things back to OSD, what worries me a little bit is that some of the larger companies that we've all been used to working with over the years have that, sometimes ace out, quite honestly, some of the smaller companies that have the greatest opportunity for innovation.
I will just say as a follow-up, the large companies are watching carefully who's responding, and I think there'll be connections made. My sense is that as we move forward, I think we'll see a change in the way that that works.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. If I could very quickly, Dr. Gabriel, how are you connecting with so much of the research on PTSD that's ongoing through the veterans community and certainly our universities and other research entities?
Well, ma'am, it's actually fortuitous. It also is going to be responsive to your previous question about small business, because in my oral testimony, I mentioned the wristwatch-sized blast gauge device. This was a device that was designed, developed, and produced by a small business, actually, less than a year, less than $1 million, and informed by the fundamental neuroscience work that had gone on in a previous program at DARPA to understand the correlation between blast exposure, in particular overpressure, and to PTSD and TBI. The program, in partnership with the Army, we fielded an entire 2nd Brigade, 4th Infantry Division throughout their entire deployment last year from August to actually just a little bit a few weeks ago. The entire brigade had, every warfighter had 3 of these. I'd be happy to pass it around. These are the blast gauges. This was developed 4 iterations very quickly with the speed and the capability of the small business to deliver those products. It started out at $85 a unit, which for the full deployment was $1.6 million. And now, because of the innovation and speed of execution of the small company and the learnings they got from the manufacturing, they're able to do an entire brigade for $540,000. So I think it's vital to pull small businesses in, not just through SBIR programs, but actually to couple them to the core programs of each of the agencies.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member, and thanks for the panel for being here, and it was good seeing you down at the AUSA Winter Symposium. One of the things I believe, our best military technology is our human technology. And I think our smartest weapon that we have are the men and women in uniform. And, of course, with that being said, when you look at the budget cuts that we're going to have, when you look at about 129,000 of our men and women in uniform we're going to send away, my first question is, what are we doing from science and technology perspective to fill that gap that we're going to be losing with those men and women to still be able for us to be successful on the battlefield? That's my first question. Then the second question is, you know, what are the key and critical programs, the top one or two programs that each and every one of you are looking at? But then also going back to what we were talked about a little earlier, how are we looking to develop common operating platforms? You know, when I was at the AUSA Winter Symposium, I saw the unmanned ground vehicles. I know we have unmanned aerial vehicles. I know we're working to unmanned sea vehicles. How do we get all of these unmanned systems on the same operating platform so we don't create such an incredible burden in the research and development systems and also in the logistical supply system? So those are my two questions.
Representative West, let me start from a department perspective. Absolutely, it is the case that when I visit men and women in uniform in the field, it's the warfighter that makes a difference. I was at Camp Roberts 6 months ago, and you know, I saw training books, I saw training manuals, but I saw the real work being done by soldiers that were able to innovate concepts that were never part of any training manual, but they just knew how to make things happen. and that's absolutely critical. On the way we leverage, the way we use science and technology to leverage the effectiveness of the warfighter, there are two specific examples that I'll give. The other panelists may have others. The first is in theater. Clearly, one of the bottlenecks, manpower bottlenecks, is in the processing, exploitation, and dissemination cells that are taking enormous data feeds and translating them to operational decisions, right? And if you visit, and you understand this well. It's an environment where tempo matters, where consequence of error is enormous, where the data is ambiguous. In some cases, it's missing. In some cases, it's just plain wrong, and you've got to sort of go through this. And we have programs across the department that are looking at ways to integrate those data fields in ways that provide much better fidelity, much better responsiveness. In the area of common operating picture, we have a major initiative with the Pacific Command that we call CloudBreak. It's a environment where we are, in fact, building across the department an integration environment for a common operating picture. Mm-hmm. It's a test bed that allows small businesses and others to come in, put their algorithms in a joint information operations center, where the combatant command actually gets a residual benefit of those efforts, and we get to see how these things trade one against another. I think at the end of the day, S&T in many of these areas has the opportunity, and we've seen it, to drive the effectiveness of a warfighter by reducing the burden, the work burden, mm-hmm. and improving fidelity of the operational picture. Giving the community access to training environments is one way to do that.
Okay.
Yeah, let me make a couple of comments. You know, the first thing is the operational capability of unmanned systems is one of the things that we really want to capitalize. We've seen a lot, and particularly, you know, in the UAVs, big proliferation of UAVs, but big utility, big payoff for everybody on using those systems at all the different echelons. But one of the things we have in the Army is then, as I mentioned in my testimony, the issue that if you indeed are going to supplement and or assist soldiers, small units, you know, warfighters, then there has to be an issue, particularly when there are things on the ground and you're operating together in relatively close proximity or you're counting on those systems to be there and not to break down and to do the things you want. That's where the technology really needs to go, the trust in those systems. And we need to be able to demonstrate to our soldiers, to our warfighters, that particularly on the more complex things, I mean, flying in the air is great and it's very complex, but on the other hand, there's not a lot of proximity there, mm-hmm. as you have on ground systems. So working these issues of how, if we are going to supplement and or help with reduced numbers of people, how we're going to do that, we have to work technology-wise on developing the systems that people can trust. That really, really is important.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Thank you. And before I forget, you asked about top priorities, and I do want to emphasize that we'll get a chance to talk about cybersecurity later, and that is absolutely one of ours, both on the defensive and offensive side, as my DARPA colleague alluded. But certainly the value of our people in the Navy and Marine Corps, that is without question. And where we think we may be able to leverage again technology, science, and this is both manned and unmanned streams. If we are going to have this huge amount of data that Mr. Lemieux described, we feel there that automation, but not just automation, the algorithms that we need to build with onboard processing that now allows not that 100% of throughput to go down to our limited manpower and pool of heroes, but now maybe it's really that 10% of vital, critical information we need to throw down through the pipes. I just offer that's an area that we think we may be able to solve some of those manpower and personnel issues on shortages. Certainly in terms of an area that we think is very important, I think I'm back to a point we talked about in being responsive to not only our COCOM and our fleet and force requirements, warfighter requirements, but just frankly our national security requirements. And that is when we look at something, for instance, over in Fifth Fleet, a year ago, we may not have had as robust a mine warfare capability that we thought we needed with the current scenarios that we're being faced with. Today, I can tell you, due to responsive technology on some unmanned vehicles and the sensors that those carried, we think we now can confront the threat in a positive manner. And I'd like to offer that was maybe a success that we saw within a year timeframe where we broke through some barriers that you might normally see. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Thanks.
One of the areas I didn't mention where we've increased investment is autonomy, and we're actually leading that area for Mr. Lemios as one of his seven priority areas. Trust, how do we trust these systems is critically important. Human-machine interface is another area that we're working pretty hard to eliminate or, you know, lower the number of humans involved in that piece. And then the human performance piece, trying to do more data fusion, turning the data into knowledge so that we can have less folks sitting back looking at the data and interpreting it. So those are the key areas we're trying to maintain and actually increase investment.
So, sir, we believe data is a force multiplier. The challenge is to turn that data into actionable information. And we're looking at that in two major ways. One is we've looked across our ISR portfolio and shifted from about 70% sensor investment, 30% exploitation to more of a 50-50, more in the exploitation to turn that data into information. And also beginning to look at activities in big data where there are emerging concepts, algorithms, and ideas coming from basic mathematics of how do you deal with lots and lots of data from big data.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank all of you for being here today. I want to go back to the Rapid Innovation Fund briefly. I know Mr. Lemios spoke about it, but I wonder if the other four panels might briefly comment on the value you're seeing, if any at all, going through the process in terms of technology and acquisition process. So if you could just...
Yeah, let me start, and then my colleagues can add. You know, this... We in the Army use this Rapid Innovation Fund, and we focused our BAA out on the top 10 challenges that I identified that were our warfighter challenges that we were looking to be able to solve. And we got a tremendous response back from small businesses and very non-traditional folks who wouldn't necessarily have responded to some of our other things. And we're really happy to do that. One of the things we did is we evaluated all of the over 1,000 proposals that we got. I had a number of people in both the laboratories and then the people who were going to be running these, what we call Tech D programs that focus on these challenges, actually doing the evaluations. And therefore, those technical program managers got to actually look through all of these ideas and these innovative thoughts and saw things that they would never, ever see before. And so we really appreciate the opportunity to do this and then to link these up so that they get brought in to our Army programs as integral parts of them, not as something separate, not as something totally different, but something that we're integrating and bringing those into our programs. In addition, I've taken the list of innovations and the things that we got, responses we got back, and I'm also looking at them for a second scrub to see if there are things in there that we may not be able to take directly to one of these tech deeds because it was a little bit out of the timeline or not quite focused enough, but are really good ideas, and seeing if there are things that we should fund out of that, out of our core program as well. So I really think this has been a big boon for the Army.
Thank you. And the rest of you have seen that kind of...
Absolutely, and I won't duplicate the small business side, but that is truly one of the core pieces of our RIF. One offer is that within that Rapid Innovation Fund, we've taken what we call our tech solutions. That's where within a year, we want to have, if a sailor or a Marine has come to us and said, this is really a detriment to my performing my job out in the fleet or the force, can we turn that kind of innovation within a year? And an offer, that's where we've seen some real successes here. It could be in things that we do even as simple as training, virtual training, that we want to get that quickly to a fleet, sailor, or Marine. Something also that we've seen innovative in terms of a counter-piracy mission, for instance. We had young officers on a ship going, how am I going to interact? Well, we've done that, again, within less than a year, we've been able to adapt that training through this kind of model, put it out to the surface warfare officer school, and now they're able to understand that that scenario much better.
In our BAA, we put high importance on transition to programs of record. So we actually the product centers and air logistics centers are actually running the review process. So we're making sure that, and the small companies are finding that refreshing because they actually have an opportunity to get into a program of record. So we're very positive on the program.
We have rapid innovation in some sense spread out throughout our programs. I talked to you about some of the activities going on with the blast gauge. That came from a small business that was part of the core program that we had.
Thank you. And if I might, I know that as we went through the last authorization, there was some concern about the process going through. Was it fair and open competition? I wonder, Mr. Lemnios, if you could comment on that.
Well, it is a fair and open competition. It was an open solicitation. The reason we ran it as a pilot, and we did this in concert with discussions that we've had with leadership here, is to make sure that, in fact, the effect that we put in the solicitation is the effect that we will see as a result of those contracts. And we have two very measurable effects here. One is, did the product of that contract actually end up in a warfighter's hands in 24 months, or did the product of that effort actually end up in an acquisition program in 24 months? I think what we've done here, let me just take a minute, I think what we've done here is we're opening a new dialogue with the private sector exactly along those lines of driving innovation in the small business and larger community. Our defense technology marketplace.mil was put online to show the small business community and the industrial base where our focus is, and we've asked for their feedback on where their IRAD is. And so we're trying to build that engagement to drive innovation.
Well, thank you. I think that helps us when we go through the next reauthorization, because again, I know on the other side of the Capitol, there were some concerns about the open fair process. I appreciate your comments on that, and thank you. We yield back.
Thank you, and I appreciate the work of the gentleman on his panel related to this very area. Thank you. Mr. Gibson.
Well, thanks, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the panelists being here today. Dr. Gabriel, with regard to the Focus Center Research Program, looking at it, it appears to be a pretty effective public-private partnership, particularly your work with the Semiconductor Research Corporation, $13 million invested and $18 million from the private side. But I'm curious to know your assessment, and beyond that, what your vision is looking at this budget, what priorities if you've given for that. Thanks.
So, sir, thank you. You're absolutely right. I think from our perspective, this is an area that we see as beneficial in a number of ways. One, as you pointed out, every dollar of federal funding is matched by a factor of 1.5 to 1. So for every dollar we put in, industry consortium puts in $1.5. It does a number of things. It advances the semiconductor technology in ways that are beneficial to the industry at large. It has structured IP relationships with the universities that are beneficial to the university as well as industry, and it has been a tremendous accelerator of training and education for the next generation of scientists and engineers in the semiconductor industry.
And looking forward, priorities, guidance, anything that we should be looking for in the coming year and beyond?
Industry representatives, the governing council that represents the industry members, they are in the midst of putting together their recommendations for how they would like to see the program evolve in the next phase, or in the next 3 years, if you will, of their anticipation, and we'll be having discussions with them over the next few months. We expect them to be articulating the type of technology areas they want to focus on, as well as some of the activities and structures of the sorts of research they'd like to support.
Well, very well, and I look forward to monitoring that, and certainly very proud of the work that our area is doing on this score. And I want to thank all the panelists again. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know the other committee members have sort of borne the heat of the day here, and I showed up at the last minute. I don't know if you can believe this, there's actually, I had a conflict So I haven't learned to bilocate yet, and it never happens to me, but this time it did. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for being sort of that invisible front line of freedom for all of us. We know that the work that you do in technology advances and scientific advances are absolutely vital to the cause of freedom, and we're grateful. I'm going to do something I usually don't do. I'm going to kind of let whichever one you think would be the best one to respond to this question. And it is a question. It's not a leading a narrative here. I want to genuinely know your perspective. Reports show that domestic military installations receive 99% of their electricity from the civilian power grid. Furthermore, numerous studies have concluded that our civilian power grid could be critically vulnerable to both man-made and naturally occurring electromagnetic pulse, or in this case, either EMP or GMD. One of your roles is to develop technology enhancements and processes to rapidly transition critical technologies to our national security force. First, let me just ask the obvious question. Do you assess the civilian power grid to be vulnerable to both natural and man-made EMP? Does anybody assess it that way?
I'm going to take a little bit of stab. A number of years ago, I was on a defense board where we were looking at those things, and I interacted a lot with our defense science board and those folks. And, you know, the answer to that question from the perspective of a lot of different folks was, yeah, we have issues there. And we have to look at those, and we seriously have to understand that. In the Army in particular, because we do have an awful lot of installations, we have an awful lot of bases that we look at, I work very closely, and the folks in my office and across the laboratory system in the Army work very closely with the installations folks as we assess what our vulnerabilities are to power and energy issues. And one of the things that we're trying to do is actually set up the ability for our various bases and our various installations to be more energy self-sufficient, more energy secure, and to have the ability not only to be more efficient and effective, but also to be safe and not vulnerable. It's a part of what we're actually looking at. The science and technology community has a part to play there, and we are in the Army at least playing that part.
No, that's a good answer. I've worked with some of the bases in our own state to that end, to that exact end. Are you aware of some of the technologies that may be available today to mitigate the threat against the civilian grid? Is anybody there? Please.
So we have certainly looked at the risk assessment and the threat assessments, but they really are base specific. There's a set of core technologies that need to be layered, and the threats need to be identified by a geographic area. I'm happy to sit down with you under a different environment and have that discussion.
Well, so there was some technology that I learned about here recently, because this has been something that's been a concern about ours on the Armed Services Committee since we heard the EMP Commission report some years ago. And the neutral phase blockers ought to be something to be considered, because the cost is minimal. It allows the grid to run at a higher efficiency, pays for itself, and it's an incredible thing to look at. So if you consider this a threat, is there a timeline available that portrays when the civilian power grid could, in your mind, be adequately protected against EMP? Or how serious is the situation now, and when do you think, what's being done to protect it, and when do you think we might have it where we'd have some level of confidence?
Representative, I don't think any of us are prepared today to give you a calendar date as to when that's going to occur or what those risks are. I will simply tell you, as I've looked at risk assessments, not only in that domain but others, there are very few silver bullets that allow you to sort of take the risk from a very high level to a low level. Mm-hmm. What we do in most cases, in fact, in all the ones that I've been involved in, is pull a red team together to do not only a threat assessment, but how would you, in fact, compromise a particular target. I'll give you a specific example in cyber. A lot of the DARPA work is informed by red teams that actually look at measures and countermeasures. Our electronic warfare strategy is informed by red team, blue team assessments. And so on this particular one, I've taken a note and happy to come back and chat with you.
I appreciate it, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back here just with the thought that if this is as serious as some of these reports that we're getting indicate, then it seems to me something that we should all understand really where we are on it and what our plan is. Thank you.
Gentlemen. Mr. Langevin.
Thank you, Ms. Chairman. If I could, Secretary Omnius, the weapons systems acquisition reform act of 2009 basically created two new officers charged with improving key areas of our acquisition process, the director for development developmental test and director for systems engineering. So Secretary, I believe that both these officers report to you almost 3 years later. What impact are those offices making, and are they helping, or did they just create another layer of useless bureaucracy?
Representative Langevin, those offices were created, were passed unanimously by both the House and the Senate, signed by the President in earlier in 2009. We stood up the offices to do two things: to first reduce the risk of operational testing, to really identify those operational issues well ahead of final acceptance of our weapon systems, and also much earlier in the process, pre-milestone B, well ahead of the final acquisition, to really understand the system risk of both the technology and the architectures that are used in our systems. We have a very comprehensive report that's coming to the Hill that outlines all of that. Our annual report is actually, I think it's due in a few weeks, and you'll see the compilation of that. But the end result of all this is that those two offices are engaged in every defense acquisition board. They are asking the hard questions. They're asking the program managers to come back with evidence that we understand the risk, we understand the cost structure, we understand the time latency of our programs, and you'll see that in the annual report.
Very good. I look forward to reading that report. Admiral, if I could turn to you. Admiral, how do you plan on continuing to execute both the solid state and the free electron laser development programs, and where are your current challenges in those programs?
Thank you, sir. It's nice that we're all here together today. Certainly on solid state laser, I'll describe that first. Working with my colleagues across the services and with DARPA, we truly feel that in the last few years, that technology has become much more mature, something that is achievable in terms of helping our warfighters out in the field. I do want to offer that from a naval standpoint, there are obvious challenges to us in the maritime domain that affect things like lasers. Being able to have a beam director that can really focus down through the maritime kind of environment and atmosphere is a challenge. But we're looking at it, and we're teaming with my colleagues here across the table. I do offer to you that on the free electron laser, we still see huge value in that, but we're also realistic in working with your staff also to realize that some of the technologies there still have a ways to go, frankly. There's some things on injector technology, some on the capacitor, high capacitor technology that we know are not in that kind of two-year arm. It's more like maybe out here in a 10-year arm potentially that we're looking at. I do want to also offer that in terms of integration to a Navy or Marine Corps kind of asset, that we also have to look at certainly the footprint aspects to a free electron laser, and that's another challenge that we're looking at, sir.
Good. If we could go back to the issue of cyber and to the panel, what do we need to change to ensure that we're better able to identify and mitigate risks in the cyber domain? I know I asked that question earlier and time ran out, but I'd like to come back to that and ask the panel to comment.
Representative Langevin, let me start. Again, the cyber S&T area was one of our priorities, and it's one that we will be building for many years. This area actually very closely follows the work that we've seen and developed in electronic warfare. There are measures and there are countermeasures. In the electronic warfare domain, those measures and countermeasures are measured in terms of maybe days, maybe weeks, maybe months. In cyber, they're measured in terms of minutes and hours. So there's a challenge of both understanding the cyber threat and responding to it quickly and building tools that allow us to both defend and operate in an environment that's greatly changing. The focus of the department's effort this year has been in building a common operating picture so that we understand those networks and we start building the measurements and the test campaign to understand, in fact, how we can use our S&T efforts and transition them. Going forward, I suspect that you will see in the coming years ways to integrate a larger number of efforts across our networks, and that's going on right now in the services and certainly at DARPA is in terms of new concepts that are being developed. We brought the department together. The department spend in cyber across the budget's about $3.4 billion. In the S&T area, it's between $600 and $800 million a year. It's one of our focused efforts. It's one that's received a lot of attention. In fact, we plus that up from last year in order to drive innovation into this area.
Very good. Thank you, Secretary. Others on the panel?
Sure. We're in the midst in the Air Force of a study, CyberVision 2025, led by our Air Force Chief Scientist, Dr. Mayberry. I'm his mission support lead, which essentially means trying to take a look at how we do responsive cyber acquisition. But what you hit on earlier is how do we develop the next cyber warriors, so to speak, because I think the people element to cyber is just as important as some of the other stuff. And one of the things we're finding is, or one of the things we're looking at, is how can we work with our undergraduate institutions, the Air Force Academy for sure, but even civilian undergraduate institutions to get more of a cyber element into the computer science and computer engineering curriculum. We've been working with Syracuse University. Our Rome laboratory has been working with Syracuse University to do just that over the last year. We're working with a couple other universities, but trying to get a more technical, cyber-oriented curriculum, working with some of our civilian institutions, I think it's going to be important to produce people that can think cyber and come into the services and help us.
Sir, to kind of trump Steve's comments just a second about the young people, I offer to you that we feel, as we've teamed up on the STEM effort that Representative Klein alluded to, we absolutely committed to that kind of focus area also within our STEM training. I use an example as my sophomore in college, my son, I talked to him, I said, what are you going to take for an elective this year, son? And this semester he said, well, you know, Dad, there's this fantastic cyber expert that's coming in for one semester. And I know that's a selfish plug at the Naval Academy, but that's exactly what we've tried to do, bring in experts from the field, because as I've mentioned before, sir, cyber isn't a traditional kind of warfare domain that you can take 10 years for an acquisition program to address. Those technologies flip every year, every 2 years. And if we can't stay responsive, not only with our training of the people, but also with our urgent operational fulfillment of those warfighter needs. And that's the other aspect quickly I'd offer that we found great benefit, and not only working with my colleagues across the table, but of the other agencies in this town, in connecting right up front, collaboratively, if there is a warfighter, a COCOM urgent operational need, a JUON that we need to address now for national security reasons, frankly, we've been able to team quickly and kind of break down some of those more traditional acquisition barriers and move in more of a responsive, get it out there kind of need. And I think we've been successful. We know there's always challenges. I'm not trying to say we're always looking in front of the target, but we think that's a way we can address that in a little more responsive way, sir.
And that implies to the people too. You're making an effort to identify those people that may not be necessarily assigned to the cyber domain, that field, and that as their day job, but it's something that they have skills and that could be utilized.
Absolutely, and we don't always necessarily have to look for a person that's in a computer science major necessarily. We want to keep them their depth of knowledge through electives, through any kind of acclimation to the cyber domain, because we think that, you might even eventually have a political science major that might want to get some kind of cyber expertise, and we can bring them into this kind of a future career path.
Thank you.
And let me just take a little slightly different slant, and it kind of goes back to something Ken said. You know, we recognize certainly that, you know, we have a need to protect our networks, but also our data and our equipment from this ubiquitous threat. And, you know, that's something that it isn't just about computers by themselves. It's by, you know, all the things that we have. And I came out of the nuclear community, you know, many, 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 many years ago. And one of the things that I did as a young scientist or engineer is I was taught that the first thing that you do if you're a designer is that you design something then in your mind, and then you have people who try to attack it, and then you have people who try to solve that as a designer so that you build in the resilience and you build in to your design the ability to make it hard for those people who want to get into those systems to actually do that harm. And so one of the things, in addition to all the things that everybody else has said, is we have to train our scientists and engineers, not just our computer scientists and engineers, but all of our design folks, to wear what we used to call the black hat, the white hat, and the gray hat, to go figure out how to do better designs of systems and to think through not just designing for success in performing something, but also thinking about how it might be attacked. And that includes protecting the data, protecting the equipment, knowing where things are. I mean, all of that stuff is going to be really important. And I really feel very strongly that we need to get our scientists and engineers across the board interested in that.
Yeah, I agree. The internet, when it was built, was never built with security in mind, and I guess unfortunately. But we're trying to retrofit now as we do it. But if we can think as we're designing new systems ahead of time, thinking about security, I think we'll be better off for it.
Well, gentlemen,
I'm concluding.
Well, I just wanted to follow up. I hate to break this to you. We're actually going to have to start training lawyers to understand some of this stuff. And I think the point y'all are making is one that I've come to understand as we deal with this issue. It's not enough for just computer science people to understand it. We're going to have, you know, cyber for dummies, because it will permeate everything that we deal with. And this is not really y'all's issue, but I do think we have some responsibility to push that. You're on to something, I think, that's exactly right.
Right. I agree.
I didn't mean to.
No, I thank you, Chairman, and I agree with your comment. And with that, I yield back.
Mr. Chairman, if I might just add one point, you're spot on. It actually is part of our responsibility to broaden that tech base. To connect the dots in sort of one last point in the sentence, and that is we have an opportunity to train new students through our STEM initiatives. This summer, we have 670 students that we're sponsoring through our SMART program that will be placed in our department's laboratories. So that's a shaping function. Those students are being selected. In fact, we have 2,800 applicants for the next round of admission into that program. It's a year of service for every year of college tuition that we provide. And we can actually shape, and we have shaped, the posture of that class that we accept into technical fields, which might include cybersecurity, might include cyber policy, certainly includes advanced technology in those areas that we see are the growing ones for the department. And that's our feedstock. And so this STEM future needs of the department shaping function actually does close, and we have a way to do it. You've given us the authorities to do this. The 219 authorities allow us to extend that, and we're certainly working across the laboratories with those authorities, and we're working to make those connections.
Mr. Secretary, let me, while we're on the subject of cyber, let me ask the annual how do you deconflict question, because anytime there is something that is the hot issue, all sorts of stuff gets that label. Yeah, we've got all sorts of things that are being labeled with cyber these days, not just in S&T, obviously, but throughout the department. So reassure us that you are looking at all of these cyber initiatives across the services, across the different DOD agencies of various kinds, and that there is some method to this madness.
So, Representative Thornberry, the Senate 933 report, which we're finishing up, outlines a department strategy for cyber integration. It includes the Cyber Integration Management Board. That's sort of the policy piece within the department to do exactly as you're asking, as you're suggesting. But I will also tell you that as part of the review that I conducted last fall with a small team, I went and I visited the laboratories. I talked to the researchers, spent time at DARPA, spent time at each of the services. One thing that impressed me, we have a remarkable set of talent. We have a good set of programs. They're a balanced set of programs. Everything from those things that might make you a little itchy to those things that are going to be operationally relevant in short order because they're being built with deliberate timelines. And we have to have that balance. We have to have flexibility. The integration effort across the department will be through the Cyber Integration Management Board that the department is standing up to do exactly as you're suggesting.
Let me shift topics for just a second. Another area that this subcommittee has been particularly interested in, kind of related to our other responsibilities, is irregular warfare. The country has learned a lot, sometimes painfully, over the last 10 years about irregular warfare. Obviously, it goes back much further than that. But I'm just curious. There is some feeling that if things wind down in Afghanistan, there will be a temptation to move on to other kinds of fights. And from an S&T perspective, is there anything that just pops into your brain that is going on in your fields that would be related to irregular warfare to help make sure that we don't have to relearn lessons again someday in the future that have been bought at a pretty high price over the last 10 years?
Representative Thornberry, I'm going to go back to some comments that Ken Gabriel made regarding the cost point for electronic warfare. And in many ways, I look at that as an analogy to, a real analogy to irregular warfare in a different domain. Yeah. So while we're certainly drawing down overseas contingency operations and we'll be moving that to a different point, the urgency, irregular warfare is really about urgency and it's about rapid transition. Through the last 10 years of war, the department's put in place a fast lane to get concepts quickly to theater. We've demonstrated that with MRAPs and body armor and other systems that are being fielded on timelines that are unimaginable to the standard acquisition process. They've been remarkably effective. They've saved lives every day. The question then becomes, what's that actually look like in a theater where the technology tempo is changing month to month? And that's actually what's driving our connection with the communities that we're trying to build these channels with innovative small business communities, with technology transition concepts, a real push in cyber to build app store models for the way we operate systems that sort of mimic what we're seeing in the private sector, where you can go to any company and buy your next product in a year's time, and you know that you've doubled the capacity of that product on the same cost point. So I think what you'll see is irregular warfare is really a moniker for rapid fielding of new technologies. And everyone here is on that, we are all on that. We are pushing in the S&T areas I mentioned, the ones that are service specific, the ones that are cross cuts, and really trying to drive new models with the private sector.
If I can kind of go back, if you look at the 24 challenges that we have laid out in the Army as saying that there are highest S&T priorities that we're looking at, and they are all focused on the soldier and the small unit and all of the things that they have had to do, but we also believe they're going to continue to have to do around the world, regardless of where we are. I think we actually kind of get at least on the Army side particularly, by focusing on those things, for a major portion of our program, not losing those lessons learned. We will still have COPs and FOBs. We will still have the issues of getting technology out to far distant people and people who are doing all those different kinds of jobs that are going to continue, whether you're in this Asia Pacific or whether you're doing anything else. We know that that's going to be there, and I think what we're doing is trying to focus at the tip of the spear. I think that will help.
Yeah, that's a good point. We don't know where we'll be, but we most likely will be someplace remote, and that is a whole set of challenges. Admiral?
Chairman Thornberry, this is a selfish plug for my colleague behind me in the Marine Corps, but I need to give him a quick shout-out. And that we do really, our whole S&T strategic plan was catered and focused to that anti-access area denial, which again needs to be forward presence and be in a 911 kind of responsive mentality. So that's something we are going to continue to do for the absolute foreseeable future. One area, though, I will offer that we probably don't think about as much when we think about expeditionary regular warfare, and it's back to that kind of information piece that we've talked to a little bit, not only just cyber, but I'm offering about the agility to that. And that's something we're looking at. It's not about residing in spectrums that only our threats know about and are very comfortable in. It's about looking about ways to be agile around those spectrums that, again, we can still be irregular and expeditionary, that they can't actually track us in those very defined spectrums we're all used to playing in, if that made sense, and from an information dominant cyber standpoint, sir.
And we in the Air Force over the last 10 years have gotten really good at unmanned ISR, but in environments where we control the air. And so as we move into A2AD and non-permissive environments, how do we do that mission? And how do those systems interact with our manned platforms is an area we're taking a hard look at. Also how we work with the Navy in an air-sea battle construct. And it's not really a regular war, but it's a new concept that we're fleshing out. And you know, one of the key technology areas there is electronic warfare, as has been mentioned. So how do we do more together in that space, as well as cyber, for that type of scenario?
So, sir, I would take it back and say that irregular warfare is really about adaptability and your speed of response. And that is the focus, as you've heard us talk about, our advanced manufacturing initiative, everything from ground combat vehicles to optical systems, and reducing the time that it takes for us to design, develop, and test and field those sort of systems. One additional layering that I would add in terms of what we've learned most recently over the past few years are from some of the activities that we had in theater. TFJDOT, which we've described to you, everything from LIDAR to the blast gauges I talked about earlier. Those came about not only with a focus on time, but a very tight coupling and integration of both the S&T folks as well as the operators side by side, so that the development cycle times weren't lengthened by the back and forth ping-ponging, but rather the fact that they were sitting right next to each other and quickly converging and iterating on a much better solution.
Mr. Secretary, I think it was you. You caught my attention with your comments about globalization of technology. Earlier this week, I was out in California at a cyber conference, and you walk around the floor, you see all these small businesses that, you know, just have, you know, it looks to me pretty amazing stuff. So I guess my question is, how, and it's really for any of you, I guess, but how do you, number one, know what's happening in technology in the world, particularly when so much occurs with small businesses that don't have the regular interaction with you? And secondly, somebody, one of the companies I met with, proudly told me their R&D budget was more than double DARPA's whole budget. You know, they seem very proud of that. So, but part of the question is, how do y'all leverage what the companies are doing? And I mean, so you got the small business, you got big companies with massive budgets of R&D. How does all that fit together as y'all are moving ahead?
Well, first of all, money's not everything, but it does help. The global R&D budget globally is about $1.2 trillion. About a third of that's in Asia, about a third of that's in this country, and about a third of that is rest of the world. But round numbers, about $400 billion U.S. companies spend in research and development. Our budget request of $12 billion is focused on those particular areas where the department either will drive new areas that we need to open, or will sustain competence and leadership in areas that we, in fact, depend upon. And as far as how do we find those ideas, you know, if you're a If you're an agency director and you've got a budget, they sort of find you. I can't tell you how many proposals I get each week. I'm not an agency director, but they seem to find me. And I encourage that. You know, we look for ideas that don't come from traditional sources. We have open solicitations. We try to build a much stronger connection with industry. I mentioned the Defense Innovation Marketplace as one way to drive that discussion. We're building a very strong connection with industry's IRAD. What I actually want to do is help industry understand the department's future needs so that they can shape their investments. You know, it's sort of like, let's partner on this and be smart about it. Industry's asking for that. The Rapid Innovation Fund is a piece of that. It's not it's not all IRAD-centered, but it certainly leverages that. So I think we're trying to build a much tighter connection with industry, having industry understand where the department's going so that they can use their budgets accordingly. At the end of the day, it's about people. So whether you have a budget twice the department's budget or not, it's really about the people that have technical ideas. And I'll, again, point back to Ken and the model that DARPA has. You know, they can rotate a good part of their portfolio because they can bring people in rapid sequence. We actually across the department are trying to build those threads, and that's critically important.
Yeah, in a way, it gives DARPA an advantage because you do rotate your people in, so they have that freshness of knowledge about what private industry is doing. I guess.
Absolutely right, sir. We rotate people in 3 to 5 year durations. That not only rotates in fresh ideas, fresh perspectives, new perspectives, but it also gives a sense of urgency to the people doing their job, yeah. Right? That they have a finite time to get it done. But I think there's two other areas in which we are leveraging and understanding what's happening in the commercial marketplace and in industry. One is 70% of our budget actually goes to industry, small business, medium size, big size, and often that is leveraging the investments that they're making and are also areas that they are creating their next generation capabilities and products. So that's ensuring that we're getting involved with them very early on with things that they're looking for in terms of future capabilities. And finally, I'd say that we're constantly looking at our own internal business processes and so that we are opening the aperture as wide as we can to bring in a greater diversity and number of folks to do business. I mentioned Cyber Fast Track in my oral testimony. It's in the written, where we've consciously worked hard to tap into a segment of the cyber community where, as I shared with you, 84% of the people that are now working with us had never done business with the government before.
Yeah. Okay. And let me go back, if I may, just to one point that is sort of the outside this country. How do we know what's going on outside this country? One of the things that we have in the Army, and I think other people have something similar, but we have what we call ITCs, which are International Technology Centers. And we have people who are scientists and engineers who are stationed in various places around the world in these centers that their job is to go out and look for what's going on out in those areas. We have somebody in the, you know, in Europe, somebody in Africa. We have all different places in Asia, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we have people who are looking for that. And they come back and they report back to us and to our scientists and engineers what they're finding out there that is pertinent to us. Second of all, let me go back to the people. Those scientists and engineers in all of our laboratories go to conferences, and it's very important that we allow them to do that around the world, because that's one of the places, just like you saw things out in California, that's where our scientists and engineers see things that are different and bring that information back into our corporate laboratories and help us to understand how we are doing things either differently or how where they are with respect to us with technology.
Yeah, and I know the Navy has a similar effort because we've talked about it. So I just think it's there is so much moving so fast. It's an enormous challenge, and so I appreciate what y'all do. I have one last question, and then anything else Mr. Langevin may have. I've been preparing for some remarks I have to give later, looking back at one author's opinion about, well, actually, he surveys past revolutions in military affairs and talks about the technologies that will drive the next revolutions in military affairs. I'd be interested if y'all disagree with any of these, if you think they're not that big a deal, or if there's a big thing that is left out. One is robotics. Second is space. Third is lasers and directed energy. Fourth is cyber. Fifth is nanotechnology. And fifth is biology, both, you know, improving our own soldiers and nefarious kinds of biology. You think something jump into your mind that he left out there as far as technologies that could drive the next revolution in military affairs? Yeah, Dr. Cable?
Yes, sir, if I may. I think one that is glaring in its absence is hyper-connected, socially networked world. As you know, everyone is now connected. We talked in my oral testimony about hundreds of millions of people walking around with cell phones. But they're connected now, and they're connected in ways that was not possible even 10 years ago. We did, as we shared with you before, a competition at the 40th anniversary of the building of the internet, where the competition was to find 10 8-foot diameter red weather balloons situated somewhere in the lower 48 states. Those balloons were found in 8 hours and 52 minutes by socially networked connected groups that had an incentive to find them. This was a $40,000 prize. Those 10 8-foot diameter red weather balloons could not have been found with the assets, the traditional assets that we had. So they are creating both opportunities and threats for us with this sort of capability.
And so Arab Spring lack examples. Your point is that that whole phenomena is a whole field in and of itself. It's not just faster communication. It is a whole field in and of itself.
Absolutely, sir. Not only for things. Imagine we set up a checkpoint somewhere, and within seconds, everybody knows where it is, how many people are there because of that connectivity that is everywhere in the world. In Bangladesh, there are 30 out of the 100 in a population, 30 have cell phones. Worldwide average is 64 per 100.
Interesting.
I guess I would add one more, and it's more of the things that it could be good or it could be bad, and it is about power and energy. And if we do not, I mean, we really have to. I mean, and sure. Some of these things like nanotechnology and some of those other things are part of that, but a real focus on where and what we can do with power and energy is really, really something that I think can either be a game changer or it can be a game killer.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. It bothered me a little bit. One of y'all mentioned reducing your investment on energy as a result of the budget cuts. I take your point. It will be central to anything we do in the future. So, anybody have anything else, or Mr. Langevin, you have any other questions?
Thank the panel.
Yeah. Well, I do too. Thank you again. Y'all timed it just perfectly. Votes are about to start, and so thank everybody for being here and for what you've done. Without the hearing, the hearing's adjourned.